Welcome to the SunShot Solar Outreach Partnership's Solar Power in Your Community Workshop Series. My name is Jason Upal from Meiser Consultants Group. And this is Lesson 4, Introduction to Solar Project Finance. So in this lesson, we're going to cover different solar ownership structure, discuss some of the pros and cons of each of these different structures, and discuss how different entities can maximize the value of solar ownership. While there are a variety of different ownership structures out there for solar projects, there are three basic ownership structures that we'll talk about today: direct ownership, third-party ownership, and community ownership. So the first ownership structure we're going to talk about is the direct ownership structure. And this is where a customer will, with upfront cash or by taking out debt, finance, own, and operate a solar installation themselves. So they'll own the system upfront, and they'll receive all the electricity from the system as well as any incentives associated from that, and replace purchasing electricity from the grid that they would have done previously before the installation was in place. So there are a number of benefits for the direct ownership structure. One of them is that once that installation is installed, the electricity is virtually free. There's no fuel costs associated with it, just maintenance costs for the panels and equipment themselves. There's also incentive revenue. So in a prior lesson, we discussed renewable energy credits as an example incentive, and that can provide an additional revenue stream for the owner of the system. Finally, for local governments in particular, they can actually utilize cheap loan money through issuing bonds or through low interest loan programs that can help to reduce the overall upfront costs and make the project more financially viable. There are also a number of drawbacks associated with the direct ownership structure, mainly that there's an incredibly high upfront cost since most of the cost is front-loaded with the equipment purchase requirements. There's also the long-term management risks associated with the ownership of the system, both in terms of maintenance costs as well as any performance and development risk that goes along with the installation. And finally, if you're a local government, you actually can't take advantage of those tax benefits. And this will actually play a role when we talk about some of the other ownership structures, but it can have a pretty large impact on the overall return on investment of the system if the local government or nonprofit entity owns it themselves. So the next ownership structure I want to talk about is third-party ownership. And in this case, the developer, rather than the customer, is the one that's actually putting up the upfront capital to purchase, own, and operate the system. So the developer pays for all the equipment necessary, and they actually own the systems themselves, even if the system may be on the customer's roof. The customer will then enter into what's called a power purchase agreement, could also be a lease agreement, in order to receive the electricity from the system at a predetermined price. It's important to note here that the developers actually take the incentives in this case. So the customer doesn't receive those renewable energy credits, and they also don't receive those tax credits. Now, this actually plays an important role when thinking about the structure that makes the most sense for a local government or nonprofit entity. Since the developer is able to take those tax credits, they can actually build the value of those tax credits into the overall power purchase agreement price. So even though you're involving an additional entity here that may require some sort of a return, it can actually be cheaper or more cost-effective for a local government to move forward with a third-party ownership option rather than the direct ownership option because of the tax incentives. There's also other benefits, such as the fact that there's no upfront costs associated with third-party ownership for the customer. The third-party developer will deal with the operations and maintenance of the systems, and they'll pay for all that. There's very low risk, as the performance of the system will impact the return on investment for the developer and not for the customer. And the payments are predictable, as there's usually a long-term contract, maybe 20 to 25 years. So there are also a few drawbacks associated with the third-party ownership structure. The customer doesn't get to keep the incentives in most cases, so the developer will actually take those renewable energy credits as well as any tax benefits. You are also involving an additional party that may require a certain return on investment, and so that can reduce the amount of value that ends up back to the customer. In the case of local governments, you can't actually use bonds under the traditional third-party ownership structure, and the third-party ownership structure actually is not available in every state. So third-party ownership has actually increased in adoption rates over the past couple of years. In the top five solar states, we've seen 50% or higher of new residential installations actually taking that third-party ownership structure rather than going the direct ownership route. So it is becoming increasingly more popular. But as I mentioned, it's actually not available in every state. And this has to do with how states look at public utilities and whether they consider a developer selling electricity back to a customer a public utility. And in that case, it requires a significant amount of regulation and it limits the ability for third-party ownership structure to work in these states. So if you're interested in finding out more about whether or not third-party ownership is available in your state, I would suggest you check out the Database for State Renewable Energy Incentives, or DESIRE, that has a rundown of all the state policies for each individual state. Now, I mentioned that local governments, through the third-party ownership structure, traditionally can't use cheap bond money, but there actually have been cases through the bond PPA hybrid structure where they can utilize the third-party ownership benefits of a developer being able to take those tax credits and build those credits into the value of the power purchase agreement while still using cheap available bond capital to actually invest in the project. So the bond PPA hybrid is a financing option by which a public entity issues a government bond at a low interest rate and transfers the low cost of capital to the developer in exchange for a lower power purchase agreement price. So to illustrate how this works, a municipality will choose to issue a bond and sell that bond to bondholders in order to raise capital. The municipality will then actually purchase the equipment for the installation. And then through a lease purchase agreement, we'll actually lease the system to the developer such that in the eyes of the IRS, the developer is actually the owner of the project. Now, the municipality can then use that money that they receive through the lease payment to pay back the bondholders, both in terms of their principal as well as their interest payments. Then the municipality, just like the third-party ownership option, the municipality will enter into a power purchase agreement through which, at a predetermined price, the developer will sell electricity back to the municipality. Developer in this case can also take the incentives. So for the municipality that isn't eligible for that investment tax credit incentive and the accelerated depreciation incentive, that value can still be built into the PPA price, resulting in a higher return on investment for the municipality. So just reviewing the benefits of this structure, there's no upfront cost to the customer, no operations and maintenance costs. They can actually use bonds under this structure. The payments are predictable, and they can also take advantage of the tax benefits. Now, the drawbacks to this type of structure is that they still don't get to keep the other incentives, the renewable energy credits. And because of the complexity of this structure, there are generally higher transaction costs. Now, this structure was actually pioneered by Morris County in New Jersey, and the National Renewable Energy Laboratory has created a fact sheet that explains how this structure worked and provides some case studies as to what the ultimate power purchase agreement prices were for the municipality and the ultimate return on investment. So if you're interested in learning more, you can check out this fact sheet at nrel.gov. Now, the third and final ownership structure that we're going to talk about is community ownership. So many customers, particularly on the residential and commercial side, may not be able to install solar on site, either because maybe they're renting the facility that they're in and they don't have access to the roof or the surrounding ground, or they may not have a roof that's feasible for solar development if there are structural issues or shading issues. So there's a huge part of the country that actually can't adopt solar even if they wanted to, and the community ownership structure helps to solve this issue. So there are three different program models that we're going to discuss today: the special purpose entity model, or SPE model, the investment model, and the utility model. So under the special purpose entity structure, a group of investors will get together and collectively purchase a solar installation. The solar installation may be centrally located, whereas the investors themselves may be dispersed throughout the community. Depending upon the number of shares that they own, they can then receive electricity over the life of the system. Now, this type of structure is not available everywhere, particularly because it's difficult to get the electricity from where the installation is to where all the investors are. It requires policies such as virtual net metering, which we've discussed in earlier lessons. The other big barrier to this type of structure is that the investment tax credit actually can't be taken by those individual homeowners. So the investment structure can actually overcome a number of the barriers for the special purpose entity structure. So the way that this structure works is the group of investors will, again, collectively purchase a solar installation. But rather than receiving the electricity benefits from that installation themselves, they'll actually enter into a third-party power purchase agreement with a customer to take that electricity. Those individual investors will then see a return on investment based on their ownership shares of the installation. So in this case, they're not receiving the electricity. Electricity is going to another customer, but they actually receive a return on investment. And because the electricity is only going to a single customer, you don't have the same issues associated with getting the electricity back to those original investors. The other advantage of the investment model is that in this case, the installation can actually take that investment tax credit. So the third structure that we're going to talk about is the utility model. So under this model, the utility will actually be the one to collectively invest in the solar installation. Then individual homeowners can actually purchase shares of the installation from the utility. And just like under the special purpose entity model, they can then receive the electricity benefits from that installation. Now the advantage here is that, again, you don't have the same administrative issues that you do under the special purpose entity model because the utility is directly involved and can administrate the whole process. So they can go through the process of crediting your electricity bill based on the amount of electricity that's produced depending upon how many shares of the installation that you own. Now in this particular case, the utility can't actually take the investment tax credit, so that is one drawback. If you're interested in learning more about community ownership structures, I would suggest you check out A Guide to Community Solar. It's a resource for community organizers and local government leaders who want to develop community solar projects, and it's available through the National Renewable Energy Laboratory at nrel.gov. So that concludes Lesson 4, Introduction to Solar Project Finance. Next up, Lesson 5, Local Solar Policies and Programs.